Yes, everywhere you go. And even in times of desperation, people still let it show. Love is a celebration.
It's an honor to be here with the world-class engineer, Mr. Danny Clay. Tell me, Danny Clay, where are you from?
Compton.
Compton, California.
Yes, I started in Compton where we cut Sexual Healing and 15 other songs on Marvin Gaye's last two albums. It was done at Cash Recorders in Compton, which is where I was trained as an engineer.
Great. And what year was that when you actually started?
1980.
So that was about 29 years ago.
That's
a long time. What actually inspired you to become a recording engineer?
Just being in the right place at the right time with the right attitude. I did not plan on being a recording engineer. I planned on being a songwriter, producer, session musician. And I had an office at the studio. And the guy who owned the studio, one of the main owners, was a friend of my dad's. So I got the chance to get in on the ground floor. And the opportunity arose where the chief engineer asked me, well, what the hell do you want? And I told him I wanted to know all of this. And he said, you start tomorrow morning.
Wow.
2 days later, little Richard walked in. It had brand new MCI equipment. Not an SSL like this, but definitely working equipment. It didn't have a lot of outboard gear, but we had just enough to get things done. We had a decent mic selection, no tubes, but nice ribbons and U47s, U87s. So we had a decent mic selection, and we could get work done, and our thing was to be we wanted to do a West Coast Motown. We wanted to have our own in-house musicians who were cutting the sessions, and so we wanted to cut some hits. That's what we wanted to do. Didn't work out that way. But that's what we wanted to do, and that was the idea, and there was always two engineers on any session, because back then you had a tape operator and an engineer. And a lot of times it would be three of us because we were a team.
That's great.
We all lived together there. It was a huge building. It was bigger than this. We all had offices upstairs. We all lived in our offices. And if anything moved in that studio, so did we. Jesus, I was there for 3 years, and then I became chief engineer. When Gene Dozier came in, and Gene Dozier was famous for doing a couple of, writing a couple of arrangements at Solar Records. He was a string and horn arranger. And Jesus, I'm trying to remember the name of the group that he produced. Atlantic Star.
Okay.
Back in the day. And after that, Gene came to us, and I became Gene's chief engineer. And from that relationship, I got hired at Solar by William Shelby and Kevin Spencer, writers and producers of a lot of those hits on Shalimar, Lakeside, The Whispers, Dynasty, which was themselves, you know, Jody Watley. I mean, these were the cats. And I became their engineer. And I just talked to Will a month ago. Hadn't seen him in over 20 years. And it was fantastic.
Oh, that's great.
It was, and I got back in touch with him with a band that came up from Vegas to play at the Peppermill. And some guys told me, hey, well, these guys are over there. And so I went and talked to them. Turns out we know the same people. They think that I'm full of, they're going to check me out. One of them grew up with Will. So he calls Will, and he says, Will, you know, I'm over here, and, you know, they got this cat named Danny Williams. Said he was, oh, Danny? Oh, hell yeah. You know, it's like, I hadn't seen Will in so long. That's really where I learned how to cut hits. Because those guys were the cats. Well, you know, I'm from Hollywood. And all of the major SSL rooms are the rooms that I use. Like when I met you over at Paramount. I was senior staff at Paramount for almost 4 years. And during that time, I worked with everybody that came through the door. I mean, I had some great experiences there. And because of my relationships and success at that studio, I got to work in a lot of other studios. Encore, Record Plant, Chalice, you know. Chalice is actually one of my favorites, and Ben became one of my very good friends because I used to work at Ben's when it was Sierra Allegra, and it was in his house in the Hollywood Hills.
Impressive.
Oh, I got turned on to that doing a George Clinton record. And Ben, the only way you worked in Ben's is that Ben liked you. And I asked Ben, can I come back? And he said, yeah. And I just kept coming back. After that, he was giving me such a great deal. He had a perfect facility. It was small, but it was an SSL, and it had all the right outboard toys. It had all the right machines. He had a $250,000 MIDI room. You know, it was, I loved it. I loved it. And the best album that I have done has never been released.
And what album was that?
There's two horn players. One's named Nick Lane, and the other one's Lee Thornburg. People know Lee Thornburg from Tower of Power, Jack Mack and the Heart Attack, and I guess he spent about 8 or 10 years as Jay Leno's first trumpet player. And we did a smooth jazz album back in 96, and Nick did all the arranging. And I should say that Nick also arranges for Dave Koz, Rick Braun, you know, Tower Power, Boney James, you know, all of these smooth jazz cats. He writes arrangements for them. So that was the most enjoyable album. Never got released. We never did a damn thing with it, but it's still my favorite.
So tell me, what do you love the most about what you do?
I, as an engineer, really like it when the creative process goes into full swing and I am seamlessly integrating the equipment with the creative flow. It is important that the engineer not get in the way of that process, which is unfortunately what happens a great deal of the time, especially with lesser engineers. I like to be transparent to the creative flow, which means I need to be one step ahead of where the producer even thinks he wants to go. I need to already be there. And that's what I like. Because that's when the shit goes like this.